As introduced, we're going a step further now. Things become a lot more complicated, a lot more challenging, but I think actually I have a very nice success story of what can happen if certain community effort starts to kick off and when we start to grow. So it was almost 8 years ago that I was with Patrick Grinke in a SECAM meeting in Lausanne, and this meeting had the title something with complex systems and GW. And people started doing molecules with GW, and at some point we saw numbers appearing and the same molecule and the same molecule, and in the end we had, I think, 6 different values for the HOMO level at GW of methane, and the spread was about 1 eV. So we decided that that was probably a bit of an issue and that we needed to do something, and we made this test set, benchmark set for molecules, GW100. Now at that moment we probably didn't realize it that well, but benchmarking GW for solids, I've been trying to do it and we're still working on it, and it's actually quite tough. And maybe just starting at molecules may be just a little bit easier, and it will solve quite a few of the problems underway such a way that we can move to solids afterwards more easily. So we started GW100 initially with my team in the Karlsruhe at the University and the Fritz Haber in Berlin. 2 different codes, which still could do the same basis set, but we had completely different types of doing the GW calculation. Then we were joined pretty soon by the team from Berkeley, and by that time we had in total already 5 different ways of doing the GW calculation itself and 3 different types of basis sets. And in the end, after 3 years of hard work, we had developed a set of benchmark results for the HOMO and the LUMO levels that were really converged. But the project actually kept growing and growing and growing. We had some chemical colleagues from the KIT that did coupled cluster calculations, total energy differences. Georg did the calculations with VASP. Giulia Galli did them with West. Then CPTK had a new implementation of GW for molecules, and they also used this set to benchmark whether their results were okay. Then it was stochastic GW started to use this as a set. Then we had another paper on self-consistency. And by now, and that's probably also very interesting, other communities in the quantum chemistry are picking up this set to benchmark other approaches for ionization potentials. And this is current status of the project. So after a while, I started collecting all the data sets that we already had, and that were, some of them are non-published. And by now I have a full database with 25 different data sets. So before we go in, there's just 2 slides here. I don't have really time, but if you want, since we are recording, you can look them up. This is the different ways of doing GW self-energy explained. And this is just if you're confused by the plots that I'm showing later, then you can always go back later in the recording to see what this is about. So this is the current situation of GW100. There's a website with interactive plotting methods. Basically, we use 3 different ways. You can compare 2 sets in full detail. You can see all the molecules, get a statistical analysis. You can make a subset and then compare all of those together. And there's this way, can you kind of select a matrix comparing some numbers. So all the plots that I'm going to show in this presentation are all generated with these online tools, and you can go to this website and you can actually play along yourself. All the data is also hosted at the GitHub repository, so if you fork it and you add your data in the file format that I'm describing there, you can send me a pull request, and as soon as I pull your pull request, your data is there as well and you can compare everything. So with all this data there, we can now have a look at some interesting things that we can learn from this data. So one example is one type of approximation that is done to do the GW calculation. And this one, we are actually looking at the analytic continuation. So here, the GW integral is calculated on the imaginary axis, and then it's analytically continued to the real axis where you need it. Now, you can do this in quite a lot of different ways. And on top, I'm using a way that is completely analytic. And this completely analytic way is really completely analytic. The only thing that is still an approximation is the basis set. and everything else is put into analytic evaluation. So that one is basically an exact result. Now, if I take results from other approaches, and we all use exactly the same basis set, and we all use exactly the same starting point and the same level of self-consistency in GW, we should, in principle, get exactly the same results. And then you can see, indeed, if we do everything very carefully, this was done with average Y-AIMS, Pas-Day approximation for the analytic continuation, that was our first very nice result. Right, so if you do a Pas-Day approximation and you individually converge everything manually, then you can get to exactly the same accuracy as a fully analytic approach. And as soon as you start to do things automatic, you start to have a little bit broader. If you only have a few poles, you kind of get even broader, and a two-pole model is obviously worst. So that's for solids, that may sometimes work. For molecules, you really need a lot of Pas-Day poles to get yourself energy correct. Now you see also there's a lot of outliers here. There's actually one over here as well. And that comes from another difficulty in GW. And this difficulty is that we're always solving the quasi-particle equation. And if you solve the quasi-particle equation, you basically have to find the intersections of some parts that are linear in the energy and the correlation part of the self-energy. And in solids, you don't see this effect that much because due to k-points, all of these points are pretty much smeared and you get something that may be a bit peaked. But in molecules, we have more distinct levels. And it actually may end up that you may end up on the wrong side or on the other side, let's put it like that. And if you're now comparing two codes, even if we do not discuss which of these solutions is the most physical one, you may conclude that they don't agree, but they may just be not agreeing because you find a different solution to the equation. So that's another thing to be very careful about when you look at molecules. Now, this is all done at the same, exactly the same basis set. So CP2K and AIMS and TurboMol all using the same basis. Now, if we want to use a comparison to other codes, we need to be extremely careful. GW is very sensitive to basis set quality. So here's just an example for benzene, where I'm comparing the convergence for double zeta, triple zeta, quadruple zeta, quintuple zeta. But you can actually see I'm trying different kinds of basis set extrapolation, different types of basis sets. And if I do the extrapolation, I actually end up in a place where most of these extrapolations agree. But you need to take care. You still have this, let's say, 0.1 error in maximally 0.1 error in the convergence between the accuracy between the Indian basis set extrapolation. So now let's have a look. If I do this basis set extrapolation, I actually looked at it for all the 100 molecules, and this is basically what you see when we compare the quadruple zeta result and the triple zeta results to the extrapolated value. So that's a number to take home as well. Even in quadruple zeta, GW HOMO levels may be off on average by 0.1 electron volt, but they could be as bad as 0.4 electron volt underconverged. So that's something to be very careful about. Okay, let's skip this. Another thing to be more important, to be also careful about, is auxiliary basis sets. It's probably a bit too complicated to go into detail right now, but all these little details matter when you start to do GW. Now, we have the basis set under control, I think. And now I think next slide is going to be pretty much the most important. In the GW community, there has been a long-standing issue. Can you do GW with local basis set? Does that actually converge? Do you need plane waves, or do the plane waves actually converge? Now, this is the result when we did a really careful comparison between plane waves and local orbitals. Everything here is extrapolated. So the local orbitals calculation is done with TurboMol. No approximations beyond the basis set. We do this basis extrapolation. The plane wave results are done with VASP by Georg himself, putting all the right new PAWs in place, doing a plane wave basis set extrapolation and a supercell extrapolation. And then we see that in the end, we can get to an agreement where pretty much 65% of the molecules agree within 0.1 electron volt. And I think That is a very important result of all of these studies, that we can really say, yes, indeed, local orbital codes, plane waves, PRW, and all electron do agree in the end when we talk about GW. There's obviously a little outlier here that has something to do again with the final an error in the mix. Now, with the plane wave codes available for comparison, we can now also look at other kinds of approaches. So now here we have the exact result for the GW expansion again. And we are comparing, here's the VASP result again. And then you see that contour deformation with plane waves also brings us pretty much close to the exact result or the numerical full frequency approach that is in VASP. The other thing you see that this one is actually centered around the same point, right? But if you look at WESP and also here at Berkeley GW, the numerical full frequency, you see there's a bit of an offset. But this offset is also exactly in the same direction as I've shown you for the basis set convergence. So most likely this offset is actually coming from a little bit of underconvergence in the basis set in the calculations of these two codes. And then you see another important thing to look at, that plasmon pole models do not work that well for molecules, especially this plasmon pole model. So after this, we can now look at all the codes and see how well you can get. We have local orbital codes. Ames is very close. VASP gets very close. WESP gets very close. This is the CP2K results. That's actually a combination of Gaussians and plane waves. You see, could be still a little issue of basis set extrapolation. And this is, again, the Berkeley. In the meanwhile, also Fiesta and MOL-GW are running the code, the full set of results, so we will soon have them on the comparison site as well. Abinit and Stochastic GW are not included because we only have a partial data set for them up until now. Berkeley GW with numerical full frequency actually agrees a lot better, but because of that brute force, real axis numerical integration, they could only do the very tiny molecules of this entire set. So here's another slide summarizing some of the numbers. But now that we have done all of this work on precision, we are in a situation that we can look at a bit of accuracy, right? So this is the final comparison that I want to show you. We've been talking about reference, right? Vibrations, temperature. So in this case, what we choose to compare to is coupled cluster. So this is coupled cluster total energy differences. It was a very tough calculation. Again, all these results are calculated at exactly the same basis set. Coupled cluster are total energy differences, and then we have self-consistent G on the Green's function level with W naught starting from Hartree-Fock, quasi-particle self-consistent GW, GW naught at Hartree-Fock, full self-consistent GW, self-consistent GW naught starting from PBE, and finally G naught W naught at PBE. So that's actually the worst thing to do, right? But you can also see a few other things that we can learn here. Is self-consistent GW naught starting at PBE is on one side, self-consistent GW naught starting at Hartree-Fock is on the other side. People have noticed this as well. So you can, in principle, tune your starting point, and then some kind of self-consistency in G can be added on top, and then you end up in the middle. So usually we have seen that 0.5% of Hartree exchange is actually 0.5 XX exchange will do the trick and put you closest to the coupled cluster results. Another thing that is maybe striking here is that all these boxes are pretty much of the same size. So the self-consistency here and maybe here, these distributions are a bit narrower. But then on top of this, they're mostly shifted, right? If you compare them against each other and against a coupled cluster. So still not yet completely sure what this means, right? Coupled cluster sums an infinite number of Feynman diagrams, and GW sums an infinite series. There's a certain amount of overlap. But for some reason, the different versions of GW do not make this distribution significantly smaller or broader. The final thing is That's something we do a lot. We just look at the mean absolute error or the mean squared whatever error, and then we say this code is better than that or this approach is better than that. Right? But that's not always very well justified. What we actually should do is do a bit of more statistical analysis. And if you do that properly with a t-test, you actually see that statistically, self-consistent GW, not starting for PBE, and self-consistent, full self-consistent GW are not significantly different from each other. Right? So you may think that this one is slightly better than that one, but it's actually not true. Same thing here, that's a border case, right? Whether quasi-particle self-consistent GW or self-consistent GW not at Hartree-Fock is actually better. Well, probably statistically it's not really clear to say that. So that's another thing that we should take a bit more care of. So with that, this is a list of most important people that have contributed until now onto this project. There's some more people, but that's basically the final summary. Thank you for your attention.